about that recently?
You know, it's about a quarter at the building, seven days, it's just getting the rules.
Mr. Farley?
So, you know, it's just a matter, and then you do it.
He promised you I won't kill you, and it'll taste good.
Hear ye, hear ye, hear ye.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'd like to call the Committee on Land Use to order and have Mr. Michael Muley to give us the invocation and Mr. Dennis Fish to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America.
If you all would please bow your heads in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come to you tonight to do your work, to do the work of the people of Berkeley County, in the government that we all serve. We ask you for your guidance, your wisdom, and your strength to have a productive meeting and hopefully a short meeting. We ask this in your holy name. Amen.
Amen. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Madam Clerk, has this meeting been properly noticed via the Freedom of Information Act?
Yes, sir, it has.
Thank you. First on the agenda is review prior to second reading of Bill number 16-61, and this is an ordinance to modify the official zoning and development standard maps of Berkeley County, South Carolina, in regards to the Muck and Foose property, LLC, for 21.4 acres, TMS number 207-00-01-055. This is located at the intersection of Old Dairy Road.
Move for approval.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any discussion?
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman.
On this track here, has there been anything from the all the property owners, anything, any kind of report back to us? Or? Ms. Simmons might have something, maybe. I think the last time we met, we talked about if they possibly could get with the property owners. Something along those lines. Kind of help us a little bit.
Sure. The only updates that I've received concerning this request, is draft covenants provided by the applicant to restrict and preserve a 50-foot buffer located along the portion of the property that's adjacent to the Arabian Drive community.
Good. Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
If council doesn't have any objection, I'd like to hear from maybe some of the property or a property owner from out there, or also the applicant, if we could hear both sides of that.
Okay. If you do we have a spokesperson for the property owners?
Do it. This lady back here.
Spokesperson. Well, we have one of each.
Okay.
Whichever. Okay, go ahead, sir. State your name and address for the record, please.
Sure. It's Jeff Vinzani at 225 Seven Farms Drive, Charleston.
My name's Jeff Vinzani. I'm an attorney with Grable, Lanche, and Vinzani, and we've been with you guys several times, so I don't want to go into a whole lot of the details other than Worldwide Equipment is wanting to build this truck dealership, provide 55 to 60 new jobs, high-paying, good jobs. We do have the members of the Muckenfoos family here who own the property right now. If I could bring Bubba Smith up to ask him a couple of quick questions about the property. I don't want to appear that we're in a trial or anything, so I just had a couple of questions. Our title search showed that Mr. Muckenfoos bought this property in 1985. Is that your recollection, Mr.
Yes, sir.
And during that time, were there any promises made not to develop the property for anything other than residential?
None that I know of.
No. Was the family ever involved in any meetings with Berkeley County or any officials, whether officially here or in someone's house or anything, regarding any promises to develop the property in a particular way?
No, sir.
Do you think that it would be unfair to say that this promise would bind your property and make it where you couldn't develop it the way you wanted to develop it?
I say it would be very unfair.
Okay. Does anyone have any questions of Mr. Smith while he's here?
I'd just like to make a comment. I know Mr. Smith says no to his knowledge, but I'm here to tell you that that conversation did take place with the property owners about not developing that piece of property commercial, that it would be...
I understand. I was asking him if he was part of the discussion.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry. I misunderstood the question.
I'm not denying that there weren't conversations that were made. I'm asking if the Muckenfoos family was included in those meetings, and he's saying they were not.
Okay, no problem. I apologize. I just wanted to make sure. I didn't want the audience to think that.
Not at all.
Yeah, okay.
Thank you. Mr. Cheryl Knight.
Thank you, sir. After that, it sounds, I don't know if you're trying to paint a picture, we could be liable or something, you know, on our decision, the way you were kind of cross-examining there, but, you know. But anyway, what kind of, or has there been any kind of consideration given to the existing property owners there as far as buffers, any kind of restrictions to help them out? Because, you know, you have to realize they've been there for years.
Yes, sir.
And on the flip side, it's a growing area. And I understand that. But hopefully, I was hoping that y'all could come up with something.
Yes, sir.
As far as a win-win to kind of help us
a
little
bit. What came up last meeting was that we said we would do a 50-foot buffer, and the planning department said, well, that's great, but we can't change the zoning code to allow for a 50-foot buffer. We can't enforce it. So what we've done is we have sent to the county planning people a proposed buffer agreement that – once this property is put into place, there will be a 50-foot buffer that will be a permanent restriction that's a private restriction. It's not zoning. It will actually be a buffer agreement that will be recorded in the Register of Deeds for Berkeley County that will permanently put a 50-foot-wide buffer that would be limited. We would try to keep it as undeveloped, unchanged, all the with new plantings put in there that will not be altered going forward. That buffer would be actually recorded as a permanent easement that would be run with the land permanently, and would, in talking to the county, they wanted to make it where the adjoining landowners could enforce that covenant, and the applicant has agreed to do that. So it would be an actual restrictive covenant that we would voluntarily put against the property that would not be part of the zoning. It would just be in addition to the zoning.
And I think also, Ms. Simmons, you might correct me if I'm wrong, with this zoning, there's a number of things that could go on this commercial-type zoning. I know there was one concern about a noise factor. If, in fact, some of that product might be sold to another business or whatever it might be, and you have a concrete crushing plant to come in, those lines.
But wouldn't that be industrial? I would think concrete crushing would be an industrial use. We're asking to change it to general commercial.
Right. Well, that's what I was referring to, Ms. Simmons, on that.
Right.
Ms. Simmons, if you can help me out a little bit.
Industrial uses would not be supported in the requested zone, but retail, office, the gamut of commercial uses, if you will, grocery store, gas stations, those kinds of things.
Okay. And talk about the buffer. Isn't there a way that we can amend amend this to accommodate a wider buffer?
We would have to amend the zoning ordinance.
The ordinance, the whole ordinance itself, and we just can't go through and just certain sections.
Right.
Okay, thank you.
Ms. Simmons, I'm sorry.
Go ahead, I'll go.
Ms. Simmons, with that being said about the buffer and the rezoning, would that then open up that property, that area for other commercial business to just come in at will?
Well, any change for rezoning would be subject to the same public adoption process that we're currently entertaining this request in. So we're also revisiting our comprehensive plan right now, which will allow us to make any adjustments based on the concerns that we've heard from the community.
Yeah, because I know when the agreement was first made, there was some concern about putting a landfill out in that area, and that was one of the concerns, and that's why the property was not rezoned to commercial. And that's a concern that I have going forward. You know, here again, I don't know what kind of adjustment has been made with the folks in that area, if any, since we last met. And I would be interested in knowing that. But I'm glad to hear that the restriction that you're talking about, that you guys are going to make it from a public perspective, right? Because county council, is my understanding, cannot enforce that.
That's correct.
Mm-hmm.
That's correct, right?
Right.
Oh, okay. Just want to make sure.
Chairman, this is not for you, Ms. Simmons. This is for the attorney, Jeff Zaney. I want to apologize, Jeff.
Here, Mr. Davis.
You try to communicate with me and...
Yes, sir.
Tell us to represent your client. I apologize you didn't have a conversation, but I think you won't get the benefit of the doubt tonight because I didn't receive any outcry on opposition, so... you may have me suited to reverse myself. I'm very reluctant like to do that, but I have not heard any counter in reference to this. And so I'm going to give you the benefit of the doubt because you reached out and made contact with me.
Well, and just to reiterate, Worldwide Equipment has over 40 locations. They've never closed the location except for back in 1981 as part of a consolidation. They closed one store, but that was as a consolidation, not because it wasn't doing good business. They hadn't laid off an employee since 1979. So during the Great Recession, nothing closed, no one got laid off. Great, they've got over 200 employees that have been there over 25 years. I mean, it's a great company.
So this is the argument you're going to make with me if we had an opportunity to converse?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, Mr. Whitley, Ms. Simmons, help me on the legal issue of not being able to enforce it from an ordinance standpoint. This in and of itself, the rezoning alone, I know it's rezoning to general commercial, mm-hmm. but the rezoning itself is a piece of legislation. It's an ordinance, Bill 1666. Why couldn't that be amended to have the covenant that Ms. Griffin-Zaney set forth? What, is there a statutory prohibition that you can't put that in a zoning ordinance?
Right. You can't condition rezonings in South Carolina, meaning that when we evaluate rezonings, we have to evaluate them based on the appropriateness of the requested change, based on the prescribed requirements in that zone.
Perfect answer. So our only hope for the people of Jedburgh is this covenant that will run with the land forevermore that Mr. Benzani and his folks have agreed to do in hopes that we will rezone it. And that's appropriate.
That's for you guys to decide.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Supervisor.
The fact that this is, and this may be direct towards county attorney or you know, if you would, the fact that you're making that a part of the, 50-foot buffer for the property is going to run with it. It would be enforceable by anybody around there to enforce that if you decided or someone else in your title subsequently decided to remove that. That has to be there, correct?
Right. You can't unilaterally change it because you're putting it permanently in place. So what we had proposed was, obviously, I don't think anybody would have standing to enforce it, but the people who are opposing us, which are the adjoining landowners on Arabian Drive, we would make it enforceable by the adjoining landowners.
Okay.
And they would be able to get attorney's fees if we violated the covenant and they had to go to court to enforce the covenant.
Okay.
And you will put that inside the agreement?
I've already submitted it to to these guys for review, and they've given us comments, and so it's in there. Yes, sir.
Adjoining landowners.
Well, that's how we're going to, we're still modifying it, but that's what it, how it will be, yes.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Chairman.
Who is it? Tommy? Ms. Newell.
What's the problem in having a 100-foot buffer parallel to those homeowners, I mean, those property owners?
Well, the ordinance was requiring a 25-foot buffer, and so we volunteered at the last meeting to give a 50-foot buffer. So we felt like that was enough, and we're going to put plantings in there to make it thicker and that kind of thing. There'll be a fence because they always put a fence all the way around the entire property for security purposes. So we doubled the buffer to 50 feet.
You didn't answer my question.
Well, I that's the first I've heard, Mr. Newell.
Well, who was it that called me?
I called you.
And I took what I tell you. Try to find as much room that you absolutely need.
Yes, sir.
And then the rest of it, leave green, so when people come out their houses, they don't see a Peterbilt or something like that. That's what I'm talking about. Okay. I mean, I don't know how big the dealership needs to be, but the folks want to come out their house and still see green. It shouldn't be the green of a cab.
Right.
You know, I'm just asking if, I mean, I appreciate you guys coming up with another 25 foot, but what would another 25 or another 50 foot hurt on the footprint of the building and everything that needs to be used? That's my question.
Yes, sir. It's very expensive real estate, and so anytime you put a permanent restriction saying you can't develop it, it lessens it. So the dealership's going to take up a good part of the property, and the reason why they bought more than they needed was because they're hoping that it would be very successful and it would allow them to expand. But if Mr. Dotson, the president of the company, would like to address that.
If you please state your name for that for the record, please, sir.
It's Terry Dotson, and I live in Kingston, Tennessee, as my permanent residence. The makeup of our dealership, the majority of the business will be performed at the front of the dealership. These tractor trailers are not small, and the parking area toward the back of the dealership will be what we would probably call a trailer drop zone or a storage area. There'll not be a lot going on back there.
Right.
It's when the trees are put there, and we've done twice the ordinance call in trying to meet with the people. We've tried to communicate. We talked 35 or 40 minutes after the last meeting. We want to be good neighbors. We're not the kind of business that has a lot of traffic. A couple hundred, 250 vehicles a day will be a big day on and off our property. We're a business to business, not a public type of facility. And we're very aware of our neighbors and the people we're beside, and we want to be good neighbors. We want to employ people in this community and pay taxes and build schools and be a part of what goes on here. We're not going to be a nuisance. Not going to be that. We never have been, and we never will be.
Well, I'm not in any means trying to say that you'll be a bad neighbor. I'm a big private property advocate. You do what you need to do on your own property, but you also need to be a good neighbor.
Yeah.
And when I had a conversation with the gentleman was, you know, find out how much you actually really need and then make the rest of it green.
And part of the issue is that the turning of these things takes a lot of space. It's not like turning a car. I mean, you've got a lot of space to turn.
I used to be a warehouse manager.
And park it and maneuver in and around the facility. And when you get to the amount of usable property and with storage and 100 units in stock that are, you know, for sale, you take up a lot of real estate.
Okay. And how much is the property?
I'm sorry.
How many acres is the property?
21, I think.
And how many acres will the
drop
yard and the front yard be?
How many acres is the property? Setback about 2 acres, two full acres. So you've got some setback on the other side that you're taking up, and then you've got frontage and requirements back from the road, and then fencing and lighting areas, and the physical footprint of the building is a pretty good size footprint.
Okay, thanks, sir.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, would you mind if I spoke to the buffer one last time? I'm sorry, Tony Woody, civil engineer with Thomas and Hutton Engineering Company. We've got the good fortune of working with Terry and Worldwide on the project doing the site design. And just to talk just briefly about the buffer, as Jeff was saying, The ordinance requires a 25-foot buffer. I mean, that didn't get in place by accident, right? I mean, there has been studies done, and a 25-foot buffer is looked at what is necessary to separate the commercial uses from the residential uses. So what we're offering is to go ahead and double that 25-foot to make it 50-foot. And when you talk about when you come out of your house for the neighbors, and what do they see as green? Well, that is in large part about how the trees and the shrubs are arranged within the buffer. In other words, I'm sure all of y'all have worked on pine plantations before. If you take a planted pine plantation and you cut out 50 foot of it, and they're all trees are in straight rows, you can see right through a 100-foot buffer. Well, if you took a 50-foot buffer, and then in turn, instead of planting those pine trees in straight rows, you put them at different angles, and then you substituted in shrubs, well, all of a sudden, you've got a 50-foot buffer that's blocking more views than the 100-foot buffer. And that's what we've done with the planting plan here. So I think the fact that it went from, that it increased 100%, and the number of trees and the number of shrubs increased, I mean, it will be an effective buffer to separate the two uses.
Thank you.
So thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Opposition? Yes, ma'am. Come forward. State your name and address for the record, please.
I'm not up here for the tall people. I'm Clarita Davey, 116 Arabian Drive, Somerville, South Carolina. And I sent an email to Mr. Pinckney this afternoon, and I would like to read it if that's okay. It's not very long. Hello, Mr. Pinckney and fellow council members. I'm writing in regards to the request of the rezoning of TMS number 20700-01055, located at the intersection of Old Dairy Road and Jedburgh Road, from R1 single family residential to GC general commercial. I'd like to take this opportunity to express additional concerns besides the ones already mentioned: air noise and light pollution and increased truck traffic. There was a community meeting on September 15th where Mr. Dotson was there, answered several questions in regards to their proposed business, and one of those was the hours of operation. Mr. Dotson told us that the trucking manufacturer has a requirement for a business to be open 18 hours, and that this facility would be open from 6 a.m. to midnight 6 days a week. However, when checking the website for their locations in South Carolina, I found that full-service facilities had different hours of operation than that stated requirement. In the letter, it has the dates, the times that the facilities are open. The one in Columbia closes at 6 p.m. Monday through Friday, closes at noon on Saturday, and is closed on Sunday. Parts and Services, however, open until 11 p.m. and closes at noon on Saturday as well. Greenville closes at 5 p.m. and noon on Saturday. Parts and Services closes at midnight and on Saturday at 5 p.m. The one in Charleston closes at 5:30 p.m. Saturdays are by appointment. And service is 6 p.m. and Saturdays 8 to 12. The back of their facility, it seems to be where the vehicles for repair are kept and driven into the shop. And if, please correct me if I'm incorrect, but this is what I got from the meeting. And backing up and starting, stopping the engines, brake compression noises from those trucks would be very close to our homes. Are there any noise ordinances that would be of concern for repairs made late in the evening or early mornings? The next concern that I thought of brought up the noise made by impact wrenches in the shop. Mr. Dotson explained that impact wrenches are not used on engines and that the facilities do not perform tire repairs. However, it seems kind of odd to me that a full-service truck repair facility would not have impact wrenches in use in some capacity, even to loosen or tighten bolts to get an engine to get to their components. Can you imagine listening to impact wrenches up until midnight? There are also numerous pictures on their website, their Facebook page, of the trucks that are serviced. Many of them are dump trucks. Dump trucks are notorious for their backup beeping noises. The sales part of this business is not as concerning as the full-service division. Please don't subject this small community to this type of noise, especially when proposed hours are going to be from 6 a.m. to midnight 6 days a week. Mr. Dotson provided us each with a business card at the September meeting as well. I sent an email to him as well as the real estate agent. The real estate agent was on vacation and did respond that he would get back to me. I have not received response to that email yet. I had a couple of questions on that email to them, mainly how many acres will the facility be composed of? Will any of the acreage be used for any other businesses? Will there be a fence surrounding the facility? It sounds like there will. Hours of operation between 6 a.m. Can you explain those requirements for those hours to us? And then the buffer, that has been answered tonight. How many acres will be paved? And what type of lighting will be there and the hours that those lights will be on? That lack of concern, that lack of communication is concerning. It doesn't do me any good to have a business card if nobody's going to respond to my emails. What happens if we have complaints or issues that are based upon the concerns that we've already expressed to the council if we don't get a response? Mr. Dotson seems like a very nice man, and I understand the business reasons for wanting to put this facility at this location. However, he doesn't live here, and we do. Please do not approve this rezoning request. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Any questions?
Any questions?
Well, let me ask this. Even with the adjustments that they're making, 50 versus 25 buffer, and with the community itself being able to enforce that, you still...
I'm still concerned, mainly with the noises that... that we would hear for the servicing of the vehicles,
mm-hmm.
especially the dump trucks. We live pretty close. Well, I live three houses down from the concrete plant, and every morning when I go out to get the paper, I hear the concrete plant as it starts up. And we all have 2-acre lots, so I'm 6 acres away plus the road from the concrete plant, and I hear that. So we've already got that noise to deal with. So okay. I don't know that the buffer would really. I don't know what that would do for us.
Mr. Engineer, could you speak to that? If I may, I'm sorry. Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
I need to get your approval to have Mr. Engineer speak to the noise that she was talking about.
We have a noise ordinance. It's Ms. Simmons.
No, I was talking about with the 50-foot buffer, and she's saying that she's got some concern about with the
okay.
impact to...
Ms. Woody.
I'm sorry, I forgot your name.
The hours of operation are concerned.
Okay.
6 a.m. to midnight is a long day.
Okay.
And for those people that have to get up and go to work, and they've had to listen to noise from the night before, makes their day really, really tough.
How long have you been a resident of Berkeley County, ma'am?
1998.
Okay.
Okay. Can you speak to the buffer, sir, as to whether or not it would have it would diminish the noise, or just what you see?
I apologize. I don't have specific numbers on that. I
mean, okay.
It will diminish the noise some, but I couldn't give you the decimal.
Okay. I appreciate your candidness.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Newell.
Let me ask
Mr. Woody.
Mr. Woody.
Kind of, sort of.
Would a dirt berm of some sort cut down on the noise?
Yes, sir, I think it would. Again, I couldn't give you the specifics. And we're not opposed to doing a berm in that. There are some trees in that, existing trees in that right. area. I don't think we would want a berm in those areas because we wouldn't want to remove the existing vegetation. But in the areas that don't currently have any vegetation, I think certainly that's a great option that we're going to have to excavate for a lake for the stormwater detention anyway. So there'll be some material on site that would be generated and we could just as easily
use it. Maybe a compromise with a berm and maybe hours of operation would help, you know, ease the mind of some of the property owners. That's something more to discuss.
Ma'am, I mean, how does that fit into what Mr. Newell is saying. I mean, if your concerns were to be satisfied with the noise, would that, and here again, the only thing, you know, I represent you, okay, without a shadow of a doubt. And I know this is that because of this promise being made years ago, not with our previous administration, but the one prior to that. And I know we can't bind one county council to another. But that's not what I'm looking at. I'm looking at my word that was given. I know they talk about promises, but I live on promises from day to day. But if there is a happy medium, there's some negotiation, and then fine, I'd like that to happen because you own property where you live. They bought property where you live. And as Mr. Newell said, I believe that a person should be able to do with their property what they need to do as long as it's not an infringement on the livelihood of somebody else. So that's my concern. I know you said you had some concerns, but you did not get a response to them. So would it be safe to say that if that was satisfied, that that your stance on that would change? And I'm not trying to push you one way or the other. I just need your honest answer to me.
Well, I still have a hard time with it.
Okay.
Because of the unknown, and because I'm a former retired from the Port Authority, I know what trucks sound like.
Okay.
I was a former truck driver as well. I know what kind of noise they make, and that is very concerning for me to have those types of vehicles, especially dump trucks. And that kind of, just like I said, the sales part doesn't bother me, but the service part does. And I don't know that that's going to, you can put trees up, you can put a berm up, and I don't know that that's going to solve the issues of, you know, the light pollution, extra traffic, possibly.
Okay. Thank you, Mayor.
Mr. Woody, right offhand, how big does the retention pond have to be?
Well, for the total 21 acres, it's probably going to be on the order of 2 acres.
How deep?
Well, from the standpoint of stormwater detention, it only needs to be as deep. You know, the depth is not important. The 2 acres in size is what's important. From that point, it can be, how much we dig it would be more a function of aesthetics than the use for a stormwater detention pond. I know that's not a direct answer, but it can be open water or not.
That's a lot of dirt. Could you put that dirt
and
build up a berm, plant it with grass? If anybody drives up Highway 52, when you cross over the Lynch's River, the next traffic light is, the business on the left is McCall Farms, one of the largest canneries in the United States. And when you get to the traffic light, they have put a berm up. And it looks like they planted pampas grass or some kind of seagrass or whatever, but it's about 6 to 8 foot high. They got a house like that photo behind you, that mansion, that their daughter built, and you can't see it. And I know that took all the noise from Highway 52 away from them. But it's a heck of a berm, and you know, you're talking about having to move a lot of dirt. Well, you don't want to have to move it 10 miles down the road when if you can move it 150 or 200 yards, you're a lot better.
Yes, sir. Again, I can't speak to the noise.
Right.
But I am confident that the 50-foot buffer, especially with the berm and planted correctly, will be a visual buffer, including the lights.
One other thing is when you light it or when they light it, they make shades for the light.
Exactly.
That doesn't go back.
Exactly.
It doesn't go down. It goes to you. And that way there, these people will not be inflicted by the light like they would.
And I think we can probably add that to the agreement as well.
Yeah. Thank you. Any more discussion? Call for the vote.
Mr. Chairman, I just have one comment,
just
for the record. I think there's some things that just come up tonight, and this is second reading, correct?
That's correct.
It's second reading. I'm going to, on the record, though, that I'm going to vote in favor, But my vote is just to carry it to third reading. I just want everybody out there to understand, okay, I'm not voting in favor of the change. I just want to take it to third reading, so maybe y'all might come up with some kind of thing before third reading. And third reading is where rubber hits the road. Yeah. It's easy to up or down at third reading. So I just want everybody to understand that.
All right. Mr. Chairman, the gentleman here, he had his hand up and we just kind of missed it. Can you give vent to him, please? No, I'm talking about the other. I didn't see your hand, sir. I'm sorry. I missed you. Yes, sir.
Come to the microphone. Yes.
My name is Hugh Hobson. I live at 119 Arabian Drive in Somerville. We've been talking, or you all have been talking about the promise. And a majority of you realize the promise has been made. You probably weren't there when it was made, but it sounds like you're trying to minimize that. Not all of you, but some of you are trying to minimize that promise. The promise was to keep property south of Derry Road from being rezoned commercial or industrial on the condition that our community would not oppose the Piggly Wiggly warehouse and future development on the north and east side of Derry Road. So why did you all make that promise? It's kind of odd to make a promise to a community to do that. The promises weren't made out of the blue. There must have been a reason for it. Well, Piggly Wiggly seemed like a done deal, so I didn't quite understand that at the time. But I'm guessing that the county was pursuing other applicants or other people or other businesses to build there, and a noisy community like ours probably would frighten them off. I don't know. It's just my idea. But anyway, soon after the promise was made and we accepted it, South Carolina Trucking, Southeastern Trucking came along, Fruit of the Loom came along, America La France came along. We had a concrete plant that came in without our knowing even before that. So at that point, the seeds of commercial development were planted on 26 and Jedburgh Road. Some of the reasons I've heard from council members for not keeping the promise, number one was the promise was made 15 years ago. Nobody could have predicted all this development. Another one was land values are increasing. It's eventually going to happen. One councilman made the statement that I can't be expected to keep a promise I made 2 years ago. Others said if it's not worldwide, it could be worse. Another asked me, why should your community be the only one not affected by the development? My interpretations of the reasons for not keeping the promise, there must be a time limit or a dollar value on a promise. Development is exploding. Residents of Arabian Drive can't stop it now. We don't need them. Because reasons to keep the promise. Because Berkeley County made the promise, and Berkeley County residents should be able to trust the government to keep the promise. How do you trust a businessman from Tennessee if you can't trust your own county council? That's all I have.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Charles Knight.
Thank you, sir. Again, just a little comment for the record. I wasn't on council when that promise was made.
I understand.
Right. Now, my decision is not based on a verbal promise that was made to y'all 15 years ago. My decision is based on looking at, y'all been there a long time as a residential neighborhood. It is going to have a tremendous effect on y'all's way of life.
It is.
I am a big advocate of private property rights. So that's where I get the tear, because Mr. Buckethoos has his rights, y'all have y'all's rights. So that's why I'm trying to gather all the information I can get to help me to make a good decision. But,
okay.
But you know, looking at the way it's laid out, I'm very concerned about y'all's way of life. I've got a lot of concerns about that.
I understand Mr. Muckenfuss has rights.
Yep.
But when he bought the property, it was residential. And nobody up here guaranteed him that he was going to be able to get it rezoned.
Correct. Okay. And those things that we'll have to weigh out as we move through.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Whitley was next. From my evaluation of this application, to the lady who spoke first, I'm very persuaded about your concerns. I'm going to vote carry forward tonight, but I'm less persuaded by the speech tonight. I don't know who made those statements that you outlined in your speech, but I reject them. And to the extent you took my comments from the last meeting where I said, we cannot make a promise as a council that will bind a council in 2 years. So it is inappropriate that anybody would have done that 20 years ago. If I make a promise, that's good for me, but it's irresponsible as a government to make a promise it can't keep and bind a future council. So I want to clarify that for the record, if that was your reference point, sir. I will tell you this. How unfair is it to the Muckenfuss? If y'all had it in the minutes or a video or an agreement to show me that where it was in writing, that would be helpful. But now we understand, I've looked into this issue. Somebody from a previous administration made a promise in somebody's living room.
No.
Well, how unfair is that to the property rights?
It was not in the living room. It was at a county council meeting.
Was it?
It happened at a county council meeting. There were several of us there. If you can ask.
Can you find the minute? Have you found any minutes?
Caldwell Pinckney was there. You think he's lying about it?
No, I reject that. Listen, I trust Caldwell with everything.
Okay.
Mr. Callahan, have I asked y'all to research into the minutes?
Yes, and I'll tell you what I found, and I've looked through minutes.
It was not recorded in the minutes, and I really feel badly that we weren't smart enough to make sure that it was.
Well, but
the meeting minutes were evidently not taken, or they didn't do it back in 1989 or 1999 or 2001. How many minutes can you find from back that area?
If it was a vote of council, it would have been recorded, absolutely. And that's the clerk of council's keeps records of all recorded votes of council. But I did find something which may shed some light on it, and this was another rezoning attempt back in, sorry, I have to get a date on this, back in June of 2008, where this came up again, and it was asked whether this was in the minutes, and Mr. Pinckney was stated in the minutes saying, and I'll just read it off verbatim, so committee member Pinckney stated that the agreement would not be found in the minutes because it was a gentleman's agreement verbalized at one of the town hall meetings held some time ago. There was a similar rezoning request, and council denied that request. And so that's the only record I can find of the promise, and I went back to basically using all the TMS numbers of any property back there to find it, and that's the only reference I could find.
That particular reference in the minutes there, that was held out in Ridgeville, and that had to do with keeping that area basically residential commercial versus residential. That's the reference for that one. It had nothing to do with this particular situation.
And just so we may be talking about two different things.
We are.
But I'll go to what this was about, and the current zoning director at the time was Jeff Tindall.
Mm-hmm.
It said Jeff Tindall continued and stated that staff recommended approval, and this is to the particular rezoning at the time. and that the Planning Commission denied the request, citing an agreement when Piggly Wiggly Center was built in the area. And so this is referencing a promise west of Old Dairy Road. And so it was, we are talking about the same thing. So the Planning Commission referenced it, and then it was asked, do we have minutes of it? And that was when your statement was made. This was about a property. This had to do with a realignment of Old Dairy Road some right-of-way that was abandoned by DOT at the time. I don't know if you recall it or not, but this
That's
is just the record.
That's when they straightened that curve out.
Correct.
Well.
Okay.
You remember when they had the
I'm DOT trying to reach back as far as I can. Mentally,
it was tough for me to find all this as well.
But what I'm saying is, it was not referencing this particular situation. My statement was not referencing this particular situation because, as the gentleman just stated, I can remember that was stated here in county council meeting. Okay, I know that for a fact. Whether it was recorded or not, evidently not. But it was right here. It was in this same area.
It was in a county council meeting.
County council meeting, let me say. I'm trying to figure out whether it was this building or the old one, but I know it was in county council meeting, so let me clarify that. I remember that specifically.
I'm just trying to make a point that whether it was recorded in the minutes or not, it happened. And we laid back and allowed development all on the west side of Dairy Road. And now it's time for us to fight for what was told to us years ago, because basically we, as our community, realized that we had made that promise and we weren't fighting against any other businesses coming into the area unless it was on our side of the road. So we honored our portion of that promise. Ms. Newell.
To your speech, I need to clarify. I want you to clarify something. The council would not follow the agreement for what reasons again?
Pardon?
You said in your speech that this council would not follow the agreement
No, I haven't said.
No, you said something in that the council would and the council wouldn't. These are the reasons why.
Well, the reasons to keep the promise?
The reasons to keep the promise. Tell me the reasons not to keep the promise again.
The reasons I heard from county council members, okay, not all of them up here, and it wasn't you, I'll tell you that, on the two-year thing, all right? It was somebody else. I'm not going to mention any names. But the reasons I've heard from county members not keeping the promise was made 15 years ago. Can't keep a promise made 15 years ago. Nobody could have predicted all the development that was coming in this area. Well, to us, that was why the promise was made. So our area would be protected from that development. We kept quiet. We didn't say anything about development on the west side because that's a promise our community made. Another reason, land values are increasing. The value of that property is getting higher and higher, and eventually somebody is going to do something with it. Okay. The one that I'm talking about wasn't you. I can't be expected to keep a promise I made even 2 years ago.
The promise would have.
Okay. Another reason, if it's not worldwide, it could be something worse. Probably true. And then I was asked why our community should be the only one not affected by the development. Well, basically on the south side of I-26, we're pretty much the only community along that
Sir.
Stretch.
All right, let me rephrase my question. What do you think
all that means?
No. In your judgment, why would this council not agree to keep that promise?
Well, because we're looking at the value of the property and how old the promise was.
Okay, because you put something in there that says something about money.
Yeah. Well, basically, I'm not, don't get me. That's why I'm wanting
clarification.
Okay. I said my interpretation, there's a time limit and a dollar limit on promises. Value of the property is going up. More taxes, more development, it's going to happen. The other is, because we were basically enticed to keep quiet on all development coming into the area, except on our side of the road, and the fact that development is happening so fast right now, I said, well, development is exploding. Residents of Arabian Drive can't really stop it. We don't need them to be quiet anymore. Well, we're being loud, okay? But that's my interpretation.
Thank you, sir.
That we, on this side of the road.
Elsie said, yeah, it was a swipe towards us.
Okay.
Did you hear what else?
Mr. Chairman?
Mr. Gunn.
Make sure we get the recording of this, the entire meeting, please. There was something else said. Okay.
Okay. Ready. Anyone else?
Ms. Hobbs, I just want to thank you.
I'm not talking about now.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Davis.
Mr. Hobbs, I just want to thank you to refresh my memory why I voted the way I voted the first time, and I'm going to vote the same way again. Thank you, okay?
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Gunn.
Call for the question.
Have a call for the vote. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposes?
Nay.
Have raise your hand on the nays. A 1-2. Okay. It moves forward to third reading. Thank you very much. Number two is bill number 66.
Move for approval.
Second.
That's 66. I have a motion to approve. Do I have a second?
It's already been seconded.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed?
Nay.
Motion carries forward. I entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
I have a motion. Do we have all in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? We are adjourned.
Okay. You can have it.
Ken, I'll stay with you when you so move. I'll cut you.
Give me your favor. Don't listen to me.
I do. I would like to call the Committee on Human Resources and Purchasing to order. Madam Clerk, has this meeting been properly noticed via the Freedom of Information Act?
Yes, sir, it has.
First on the agenda is the review of hiring freeze to release funds for position openings as submitted in our packet. I'll entertain a motion for approval.
So moved.
Second.
Any questions or concerns for Ms. Mitchum?
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Newell.
Could you speak up a little bit? I can't hear you, sir.
A little closer to the mic might help.
I'm glad the two of you can hear. We will proceed without you. A motion and a second. All those in favor signify with aye. Opposed? The ayes have it.
Thank you,
Ms. Mitchum. Number two is the Volvo project, the roadway improvements to Centerline Road.
Move for approval.
Second.
This is change order number one and number last, right, Mr. Blankenship?
That's correct.
All Mr. right. But I have a motion for approval from who? Well, is there a second? Mr. Fish? Any questions for Mr. Blankenship?
Keep saving us money.
Trying.
Les, thank you for your work on this change order. I appreciate it.
Yes, sir.
I'll call the question. All those in favor signify with aye. Opposed, nay. The ayes have it. Thank you, Les.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Next, we have a need for an executive session.
Great.
And without objection, I would ask that we combine the executive sessions of Human Resources and Purchasing and Justice and Public Safety Committees into one executive session. I will entertain a motion.
So moved.
for executive session to discuss contractual matters, personnel issues, and potential liabilities in the communications department. I have a motion from Mr. Newell. I need a second.
Second.
Any concerns or questions? All those in favor signify with aye.
Aye.
Opposed? We'll be back shortly, ladies and gentlemen.
We'll see you all tomorrow.
Mr. Chairman?
Chairman.
May I state the reason for my executive session, please?
Mr. Gunn, I think I stated yours, but I think I didn't state mine. So please state them all.
Discuss personal issues and potential liabilities in the communications department.
I said that one. How about Mr. Attorney on mine?
To discuss contractual negotiations related to new radio system procurement.
All right. So for those bases, all those in favor, signify with aye.
Aye.
Opposed? We're in executive session.
I would like to call the Committee on Justice and Public Safety meeting to order. Madam Clerk of Council, has this meeting been properly noted via the Freedom of Information Act?
Yes, sir, it has.
Okay, thank you. First item on the agenda is the status report on the Independent Fire Study RFQ. Ms. Christy Davis.
Mm-hmm.
We saw you just a couple weeks ago.
How are you? Thank you. We are hoping to have the draft ready by the end of the week. I have assisted another director that has expertise in this to come up with some more specifications for this project, so we hope to have a draft by the end of the week.
By the end of the week, is that what I heard?
Yes, sir. To have it by the end of the week.
With a hope on it, okay.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Newell.
I'm first.
I heard you.
Mr. Newell.
Who is coming up with this scope? Who's creating it?
We did some research from other entities and states, but I have asked Dan Barb to help because that's the expertise of their area to come up with this, to get the specifications.
Is it part of procurement to come up with scopes, or is it the departments that's supposed to come up with scopes?
We will assist them, but this project's never been done previously. This is a brand new one, so we're trying to do a lot of research because we just don't want to piece it together quickly.
Thank you, ma'am.
But it is the department's.
Well, you're doing a fine job, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone else?
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Whitley.
Who's on the, have you named the committee?
Yes, sir, but I would prefer not to say who's on the committee on record. I mean, I will.
I'll give you a pass. Can you tell me?
Thank you.
Thanks. Anyone else? Thank you.
Thank you.
We took care of the executive session.
Move for adjournment.
Second.
I have a motion to adjourn and a second. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
We are adjourned. Thank you.
I'd like to call the Finance Committee meeting to order. Madam Clerk, has this meeting been properly noticed via the Freedom of Information Act?
Yes, sir, it has.
Thank you. First on the agenda is approval of minutes from the regular finance meeting on October 24th, 2016.
Second.
Are there any corrections to these changes to these minutes? If none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? None stand approved as presented. First item on is the South Carolina Department of Public Service Justice Assistance Grant. Grant number, Ms. Marshall.
Good evening. Berkeley County has been awarded a grant from the South Carolina Department of Public Safety Justice Assistance Grant number 1G16008 in the amount of $171,000 and some odd cents, some odd dollars, $171,653,000, and this is for portable radios for the Sheriff's Department. This grant does require 10% non-federal match of $17,165. This grant was brought before the council before we submitted, and at that time they did approve the submittal of this application. We are asking that you grant the county supervisor the authority to sign and enter into the grant agreement.
Move for approval.
Mr. Chairman.
Second any discussion.
Mr. Chairman, did you review the conditions? These seem different than previous ones.
They're pretty standard. This one, this grant actually came down through the state.
Right.
So the conditions are just a little bit different, but basically they're the same thing.
It seemed less onerous to me than the feds.
Well, it's because the state takes on a lot of that responsibility.
Which I appreciate. Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Any other questions?
Mr. Chairman.
That $17,000 coming out of fund balance?
No, sir. That $17,000 will be coming out of the $30 million bond funds for the radio network.
Thank you, Ms. Gallagher.
Any other questions? All in favor, signify by saying aye. Opposed? Motion carries. And also the other grant, different grant, HS-2817, Ms. Marshall.
Yes, this is a grant again from the South Carolina Department of Public Safety. This is a continuation grant for the DUI enforcement officer that the sheriff's office employs in the amount of $61,259. This grant does not have a match. And as I said, this is a continuation of the grant from last year. So this will continue to fund that position for another year.
How long will this be funded, do you know?
It's for 1 year. They will fund up to 3 years, and at that point, we'll reapply again for that same position.
Okay.
They've had that position, I think, for a few years now. I know this last application we did submit for two officers and one car. We were only awarded to continue that one officer.
The second year of this program, you expect it for one more year, probably?
There will be a third year for sure. We ask that you grant the county supervisor to enter into that a grant agreement.
Move to approve. Second.
Have a motion second. Any discussions or questions? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you.
Consideration prior to first reading.
Councilman Fish, the company has requested that this first item be removed from the agenda.
I'm sorry?
The company has requested that this item be removed from the agenda.
Too bad.
Held indefinitely or defeated.
Ready to move on next one? Okay. Consideration of prior first reading bill number 16-67, orders authorizing execution and delivery of fee in lieu of tax and incentive agreement bond between Berkeley County, South Carolina, and GPT Somerville Owner LLC, acting for itself and one or more affiliates, others, and product sponsors, the company, pursuant of which the county shall covenant to accept certain negotiated fees in lieu of ad valorem taxes.
Move approval.
No, the company wants to remove that one.
Remove that one.
Yeah,
I'm sorry.
So, yeah, 16-67 has been
and that's
removed.
The only one?
Okay, so prior to second reading now.
Okay, second reading, okay. Just that one. Prior to second reading is bill number 1641.
Move for approval.
Have a motion, is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion, questions? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Bill number 1665, ordinance and execution delivering fee in lieu of agreement bond between Berkeley County and the company known as Products South Shore.
For approval. Second.
A motion is second. Any questions? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Review prior to third reading. Bill number 1648.
Councilman Fish, the company has requested that we hold this one until the December meeting. This is a different one. Sorry.
That was held also. Okay.
1657.
Bill 1657. Yes. Ordinance authorizing delivery by Berkeley County and special source revenue credit between Just Plain Properties LLC, Just Plain Properties 2 LLC.
Move for approval.
Motion and second?
Second.
All in favor or any questions? All in favor signify by saying aye. Opposed? Motion carries. Bill number 16-58. Ordinance authorizing execution fee and lead agreement by Berkeley County and Vulcan Construction Materials.
We have a motion and a second.
Motion and second. Any questions? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Bill number 1659. Ordinance execution of tax fee and lieu of tax agreement by and between Berkeley County and
Vulcan Standards.
We have a motion and a second. Any questions?
Who seconded it?
Second.
Okay.
All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The motion carries. Bill number 1660. Ordinance authorizing execution fee in lieu of tax agreement.
Second.
Brothers. I have a motion and a second. Any other questions?
Mr. Chairman. Is that asphalt plant off of 52 across from Mount Holly?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
All right. Just want to make sure.
Yep. Any other questions?
No. Any other questions? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. is a consideration of a resolution to enter the state of Berkeley County to enter into a fee agreement with Project South Shore Project, South Shore Developer, and our respective designers.
Move for approval.
Motion, is there a second?
Second.
Is any questions? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, motion carries.
Councilor Fish.
Execution.
This is the last one. But this is the resolution that corresponds with 1667, so it can be removed as well.
Okay, this, oh, okay.
So which one are we on now?
Number three.
Number three. Resolution of County Council Berkeley.
Move for approval.
Assessment.
Second.
Next on improvement district. Have a motion, a second. Any questions? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
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 Motion carries. Resolution of County Council.
Move for approval.
Second.
Also, next to improvement district. Any questions? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed? Motion carries. And the last one, resolution authorizing execution of fee in lieu agreement between Berkeley County.
Move for approval.
And U.S.
Second.
Real Estate Trust. Any questions?
Yes,
any
sir. What is that in regards to?
Yeah.
Mr. Attorney?
No, TBC Group.
This is a transfer in ownership of the property owner who owns the Tire Kingdom property. Currently, okay. It's owned by U.S. Industrial REIT.
All right.
REIT.
All right. Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries.
Move for approval. Adjournment.
All in favor to adjourn, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Or adjourn. Lost time.
I'm not saying that.
All right. I'd like to call the public hearings to order. Madam Clerk, has this meeting been properly noticed via the Freedom of Information Act?
Yes, sir, it has.
All right. Thank you. Number one on the agenda is Bill 1648, an ordinance authorizing the execution and delivery of fee in lieu of tax and incentive agreement lying between Berkeley County, South Carolina, County and C.R. Bard, a company formerly identified as Project HARP, acting for itself, one or more affiliates and or other project sponsors, the company pursuant to other project pursuant to which the county shall covenant to accept certain negotiated fees in lieu of ad valorem taxes with respect to the establishment and or expansion of certain facilities in the county collectively the project. Two, the benefits of a multi-county industrial or business park to be made available to the company and project. Three, certain special source revenue credits in connection with the project. And four, other matters relating thereto. Would anyone like to speak on bill number 1648? Hearing none, that concludes that public hearing. Bill number 1650, an ordinance amending the ordinance numbers 96-07-35 and 13-06-19 to abolish the Berkeley County Special Fire Tax District Advisory Commission. Would anyone like to speak on bill number 16-50? Hearing none, that concludes that public hearing. Bill number 1651, an ordinance to modify the official zoning and development standards maps of Berkeley County, South Carolina in regard to Robert Hood for TMS number 10400040, 9.42 acres, located at 1324 North 17A, Punks Corner, from Flex 1 Agricultural to RNC Rural and Neighborhood Commercial Zone Districts to R3 Mobile Home Park Zoning District. Would anyone like to speak on bill number 1651? Hearing none, that concludes that public hearing. Bill number 1652, an ordinance to modify the official zoning and development standards maps of Berkeley County, South Carolina, in regard to Keith and Rita Schlichter, for TMS number 241-0003-006, 4.06 acres, located on Hunt Drive near Bates Pond, Hugie, from R2 Manufactured Residential District to R2R Rural Manufactured Residential District. Would anyone like to speak on bill number 1652? Hearing none, that concludes that public hearing. Bill number 1653, an ordinance to modify the official zoning and standards maps to Berkeley County, South Carolina, in regard to Oren and Dorpa Parlor, for TMS number 207-0002013, 3.62 acres, located at the intersection of Drop-Off Drive and Jedburgh Road from Flex 1 Agricultural District, PDOP/IP, International Mercantile Park Plan Development District,
with land use designation of commercial and office institutional. Would anyone like to speak on bill number 16-53? Hearing none, that concludes that hearing. Bill number 1654, an ordinance to modify the text of the International Mercantile Park Plan Development Office Park/Industrial Park, PD-OP/IP from of Berkeley County, South Carolina, in regard to Drop Off Drive Development LLC and Jedburg Investments LLC for TMS number 207-00-02140 and 207-00-02012, 84.5 acres located at Drop Off Drive Jedburg SC. Would anyone like to speak on bill number 1654? Hearing none, that concludes that public hearing. Item 7, bill number 1655, an ordinance authorizing a lease agreement with Nexon Regional Improvement Association, NRIA, for the operation and maintenance of parks and recreational improvements in the Nexon development. Would anyone like to speak on bill number 16-55? Hearing none, that concludes that public hearing. Bill number 16-57, an ordinance authorizing delivery by Berkeley County of a special source revenue credit agreement with Just Plain Properties LLC, Just Plain Properties 2 LLC, and Grand Forest Incorporated, and other matters relating thereto. Would anyone like to speak on bill number 1657? Hearing none, that concludes that public hearing. Bill number 1658, an ordinance authorizing execution delivery of fee and lieu tax agreement by and between Berkeley County and Vulcan Construction Materials, LP, a Delaware Limited Partnership, whereby Berkeley County will enter into a fee in lieu of tax agreement with Vulcan Construction Materials, LP, a Delaware Limited Partnership, and providing for payment by Vulcan Construction Materials, LP, a Delaware Limited Partnership, of certain fees in lieu of ad valorem taxes, providing for the special source revenue, providing for the allocation of fees in lieu of taxes payable under the agreement for the establishment of a multi-county industrial/business park and other matters relating thereto. Would anyone like to speak on bill number 1658? Hearing none, that concludes that public hearing. Bill number 1659, an ordinance authorizing the execution and delivery of a fee in lieu of tax agreement by and between Berkeley County and E.F. Sanders, LLC, whereby Berkeley County will enter into a fee in lieu of tax agreement with E.F. Sanders, LLC, and providing for payment by E.F. Sanders, LLC, of certain fees in lieu of ad valorem taxes, providing for special source revenue, providing for the allocation of fees in lieu of taxes payable under the agreement, and the establishment of a multi-county industrial/business park and other matters relating thereto. Would anyone like to speak on bill number 1659? Hearing none, that concludes that public hearing. Bill number 1660, okay, an ordinance authorizing the execution and delivery of fee and lieu tax agreement by and between Berkeley County and Sanders Brothers Construction Company, Incorporated, whereby Berkeley County will enter into a fee and lieu of tax agreement with Sanders Brothers Construction Company, Incorporated, and providing for the payment by Sanders Brothers Construction Company, Incorporated, of certain fees in lieu of ad valorem taxes, providing for the special source revenue, providing for the allocation of fees in lieu of taxes payable under the agreement for the establishment of multi-county industrial/business park and other matters relating thereto. Would anyone like to speak on bill number 1660? Hearing none, that concludes that public hearing. I'll adjourn the public hearings and be back in a moment with the regular county council meeting.
Second.
I'd like to call the regular county council meeting to order. Madam Clerk, has this meeting been properly noticed via the Freedom of Information Act?
Yes, sir, it has.
All right. First on the agenda is approval of minutes from special council meeting held on October 4th, 2016, and the regular public hearing and council meetings held on October 24th, 2016. Do I have a motion?
I motion.
Moved. Second. Is there any corrections to these minutes? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? The motion stands as presented. Next is public discussion. Do we have anyone signed up? Please remember to give your name, address, and speak into the microphone. There is a time limit of 4 minutes. Mr. Hobson, I think they were available earlier and they had their speech. And Ms. Clarita Davey of Arabian Drive also?
Yep, there you go.
There you go. Okay.
Lack of
all right. Reports from standing committee. Committee on Finance, Chairman Dennis Fish, District Number 5.
Mr. Chairman, the Committee on Finance met on November the 14th, 2016, and early this evening. On recognition of the committee, I move to approve granting the county supervisor authority to enter the South Carolina Department of Safety Judges Assistance Grant, number 1G16008.
I have a motion to approve. Is there any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
Also, on recommendation of the committee, I move to approve the granting of the county supervisor authority to move to the 2017 South Carolina Department of Public Safety Grant 2017 HS 2817 in the amount of $61,259 for the continuation of the DUI grant funded position in the sheriff's office.
Okay, I have a motion to approve. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
Chairman, that concludes my report.
All right, thank you. Committee on Land Use, Chairman Philip Farley, District Number 1.
Mr. Chairman, the Committee on Land Use met on November 14, 2016, and earlier this evening, and all items on the agenda have been addressed. Mr. Chairman, that concludes my report.
Thank you, sir. Committee on Human Resources and Purchasing, Chairman Joshua S. Whitley, District Number 2.
Mr. Chairman, the Committee on Human Resources and Purchasing met on November the 14th, 2016, and earlier this evening. On recommendation of the committee, I move to approve awarding the BCWS Landfill Cell 13 project to Atlantis Commercial Group in the amount of $2,997,616.
I have a motion. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
Also, on recommendation of the committee, I move to approve unfreezing the positions requested by the Human Resources Director earlier this evening.
I have a motion. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
Finally, on recommendation of the committee, I move to approve the Volvo project roadway improvements to Centerline Road, change order number 1, landmark construction, in the amount of $2,848,094.78.
I have a motion. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
Mr. Chairman, that concludes my report.
Thank you, sir. Committee on Justice and Public Safety, Chairman Kenneth E. Gunn, Jr., District Number 3.
The Committee on Justice and Public Safety met on November 14, 2016, and earlier this evening. Ms. Davis gave a status report on the independent fire study, RFQ, indicating hopes that a draft will be available at the end of this week. Also, on recommendation of the committee, I move to approve permitting the Sheriff's Department to retain 15 vehicles in their current fleet.
Was that on the
Yeah, it's,
you weren't here.
Oh, it's 4B.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
You were playing hooky.
We have to vote.
No action necessary on that either.
We need to vote.
You got to vote.
You have a motion.
All right. I have a motion. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Okay. Committee on Water and Sewer, Water and Sanitation, Chairman Steve C. Davis, District Number 8.
No report, Mr. Chairman.
Report.
Thank you, sir, Mr. Davis. Committee on Facilities and Infrastructure. Chairman Tommy Newell, District Number 4.
Behave.
No report, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, sir.
We're not building any roads.
Committee on Human and Community Services, Chairman Caldwell Pinckney, Jr., District Number 7.
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman. The Committee on Human and Community Service met on November the 14th, 2016. On recommendation of the committee, I move to approve granting the county supervisor authority to sign and submit the undiscovered SC grant application.
I have a motion. Is there any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
Mr. Chairman, that concludes my report.
Thank you, sir. Committee on Economic Development, Chairman Jack H. Shirlnight, District Number 6.
No report, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, sir. Next is third reading, Bill Number 1648.
Move for approval.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion?
Wait, is this 1648?
1648, yes.
Yeah, that one needs to be held until the December meeting.
Okay.
Thank right. you.
How about 1650? Is it okay to proceed?
As far as I know.
Our tax history.
I withdraw okay. my motion.
All right, Bill Number 1650, an ordinance amending ordinance.
Move for approval.
Second.
Motion is second. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. All right. Bill Number 1651. Mr.
Move for approval. Second.
This is yours, Mr. Hood. Motion is second. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. All right. Bill Number 1652, an ordinance to modify.
Move for approval.
Second.
A motion and a second. Is there any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Bill Number 1653, an ordinance to modify the official county zoning and development standards.
Move for approval. Second.
All right, we've got a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Bill number 1654, an ordinance to modify the text of International Mercantile Park Plan Development Office.
Move approval.
Second.
Got a motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Bill number 16.
Move for approval.
Second.
Okay, a motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Bill number 1657.
Move for approval.
Second.
I got a motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Bill 1658.
Move for approval. Second.
Motion and a second. Is there any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. All right, Bill number 1659.
Move for approval.
Second. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. 1660, for Sanders Brothers.
Move for approval.
Got a motion? Got a second? Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Next is second reading. Bill number 1644.
Move for approval.
Second.
Okay.
That was held before.
Now, all right.
Is that one held?
Okay, got a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Bill number 1661, ordinance modified.
Move for approval.
Second.
Second.
Motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
Nay.
One nay.
We have one nay. Mr. Newell was naying?
No, it's not.
It's Mr. Pinkney.
No, down here, Supervisor Caldwell Pinkney.
Oh, okay.
Yes, sir.
Y'all sound a lot alike.
Oh, wow. I don't know how to take that one.
I would object.
I object to that.
Okay. Bill number 1661, an ordinance modified official zoning maps of Berkeley County, South Carolina in regard to.
We just did that one.
We just did that one.
That was Jeb's one, Jeb, we just did that one.
We just did 1661.
Okay, we just did that one, okay. Bill 1662.
Move for approval. Second.
Okay, Mr. Cooper, motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? No, motion carries. Motion, Bill number 1663, an ordinance to modify the official zoning development standards map.
Move for approval.
Second.
Motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Bill number 1665, an ordinance authorizing.
Move for approval.
Delivery.
Does that help?
I got a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Bill number 1666, an ordinance.
Move for approval.
Second.
Motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Next is first reading. All bills for first reading are read into the record.
Chairman?
I'm sorry?
This is the one that the company has requested removal of, the first one.
Okay, all right. And so I have nothing else there than the.
Resolution.
Next is resolutions. Resolution to state the commitment of Berkeley County.
Move for approval.
Second.
I got a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
All right. A resolution authorizing a fee.
And Mr. Chairman, this is the resolution that's associated with that ordinance.
Okay, thank you. All right, now how about number three?
Move for approval.
A resolution, Berkeley County Council.
Move for approval.
We've got a motion and a second. Do we have a second?
Second.
All right. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Item four, resolution.
Move for approval.
Council.
Second.
Okay, I got a motion and a second. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Item five, a resolution authorizing.
Move for approval.
Second.
Motion, second. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Next is nominations for membership on boards and commissions. Are there any? Okay. Hearing none, I guess the next is announcements. And the December 2016 meeting, Federal Committee and Council meetings will be held on Monday, December 12th, 6 o'clock in the Assembly Room, Berkeley County, South Carolina Administration Building, 1003, Highway 52, Monk's Corner. Entertain a motion to adjourn.
That's the only meeting in December, correct?
Is it second? All in favor?
Aye.
You going what now?
It's the only meeting in December.